Hey everybody, welcome to my YouTube channel, or welcome back. My name is Daniel Hickson, and I'm a Christian pastor, and I'm somebody who's very interested in John Wesley, C.S. Lewis, and figures like that. And I'm also a member of the Anglican Church in North America. I'm ordained in the Anglican Church, ACNA, which is a gathering of Anglican dioceses and congregations into what's called a province. Just if you don't know what that is, the ACNA is the North American province, and we are in fellowship or full communion with other Anglican provinces around the world, and in places like Africa or Asia and really all over the place. And so I want to reflect a little bit on the provincial assembly at La Trobe, Pennsylvania, which I was fortunate enough to attend just a couple weeks ago now. So just kind of reflecting a little bit. If you look at my YouTube channel, I published a couple of videos while I was there talking to a couple of different people. And so I want to just share some kind of thoughts and wrapping the whole thing up together. So it was the 15th anniversary of the gathering of the province. Of course, many of the churches and the diocese that helped to form and birth the Anglican Church in North America, the province, many of them are actually much older. The church that John Wesley served as a pastor in Savannah, Georgia, was founded in the 1730s, and it is a part of the Anglican Church in North America. So you get a sense that the province was sort of, as it is currently networked together, begun in 2009. So we went up to La Trobe, Pennsylvania. I'm going to share some pictures. And I had to fly into Pittsburgh, rent a car, drive another hour and a half to get up there. And I thought, man, this place is really inconvenient to get to. But when I got up there, I got a sense of why we were there. We went to St. Vincent College. And this is a Roman Catholic liberal arts college. It's co-ed. But it's also a monastery. And I think it's one of the oldest, if not the oldest, Benedictine monasteries in the United States. And so we got up to go to this place, and it's just beautiful. As you see in this picture, and I'm sharing a few pictures, just a couple that I took with my phone, it was set amidst these kind of rolling hills and ridges, and it was very green. It was pretty warm while we were there. The first couple of days, some rain came through and cooled it off, but just a beautiful place. And I got up there and I realized I see why we came to this inconvenient place. This is the church, the Abbey Church. I believe it's called St. Vincent's Basilica. And it's right in the center of campus. And this is where we had our opening and our closing Eucharist, our communion service. And I'll talk about that in a moment. But just as you see, a beautiful place. And the church, every time I tried to go in it, it was open. I didn't try to go at 2 a.m. or anything, but it may always be open. And there were side chapels that you could go in. One had just was full of candles, like all the time. And it was very just beautiful, very striking. So I'll share some of the pictures, but it was just a great place to get away, to pray, to slow down. And so it was, I'll draw some comparisons to my experience going to annual conferences in the United Methodist Church and the Louisiana Conference. In some ways, it was a lot like going to annual conference. We had business sessions, we had worship services, we had that big room with all the tables and different organizations and booksellers and mission agencies. But in other ways, it was quite a different experience. And it felt in many ways more like going on a retreat with a whole bunch of other people. And there were about 1,000 people, clergy and laity from across North America and even beyond other Anglican provinces. And so one of the really big differences between this and going to annual conference is that it felt like the ACNA Provincial Assembly, we got together to pray, we got together to worship. And while we were there, we did some business, but the business in terms of the total amount of time was pretty short. But there was a lot of fellowship, a lot of celebration together, and a lot of worship. In fact, we had not only a Eucharistic service, a communion service every day, but there was also morning and evening prayer services every day following the Book of Common Prayer, which is sort of the worship book. And really, it's kind of a manual for the Christian life. to more than just a worship book, but it is the worship book for the Anglican Church. And so we had a Eucharist service every day. We had morning and evening prayer every day. And then each of our big plenary sessions began with a time of praise and worship and reciting Psalms and praying some of the prayers from the Common Prayer Book. And so worship pervaded the whole atmosphere of a thing. And that combined with a beautiful location, it really was like being on a retreat. And so it was a great experience in that sense, and very rejuvenating. It was very refreshing for me. Here's a little garden behind the basilica, and there was a lot of green space, and it was just really, really gorgeous. This was a door inside the basilica, and I just love the woodwork there. And this is the inside, as you see, beautiful, beautiful church. This was in the evening as the sun was going down. You could see it pouring through the stained glass. And behind me, as I took this picture, there was an icon of Christ. I think it was Christ, the Good Shepherd, on the wall. And the light was like beaming right down on it. And so just a beautiful place just to sit and to pray and to be. And a lot of people, I think, took advantage of that throughout the time we were there. One of the really cool things about, for me, going to Provincial Assembly was I got to meet in person people that I had seen on the internet, on Facebook forums, on YouTube channels, on blogs and things like that, but never actually had the opportunity to meet in real life. So when I first got there, one of the first people I saw was actually Matt Kennedy, who keeps a blog and is very active on Facebook. And I was like, hey, I recognize that guy's face, even though we've never met. I did a video, which you see posted on my channel, having a conversation with Joe from the Young Anglican channel. He does some really good content. I saw some other people that I recognized from different renewal groups and different web sources. Saw Phil Ashy, who does the American Anglican Council stuff. Actually was standing kind of close to him while he was filming a video in the room with all the tables. And I was like, hey, I'm subscribed to his channel, you know? So that was just kind of cool. And being someone of somewhat short stature, I was amazed at just how much taller everybody was in real life than I expected. So just meeting people, and not just internet people, but just the leaders from around the province and from around the world. Our Bible study leader every morning was the Bishop of Singapore. We heard from the Archbishop of, I think it was Nigeria, about coming to faith in Christ from a Muslim background, and then how he faced persecution. Boko Haram, the Islamist group, put out a hit on him, and someone was actually shot in his home. And his church continues to grow and expand, and they're blessed by the Spirit of God. And just to hear these great stories of growth and God doing new things and people overcoming persecution just from all over North America, all over the world. It was such a celebration. And that was a big difference as well. I have to say, when I first joined the Louisiana Conference in the United Methodist Church, we actually were growing. We were one of the very few conferences in the UMC at that time that was growing. I would say we were sort of a moderately evangelical conference at that time. But after a few years, though, that stopped, and really from then on, every annual conference I went to was really kind of about we're in decline. What can we do? We need to work harder. We need to try new things. We're in decline, and of course, the denomination, the UMC, has been in decline since it was formed in 1968. Now that decline is radically accelerated, which I think speaks to just systemic problems, but the fact that they've never had a year of growth in the U.S. But to go to the ACNA, it was a different experience. We were hearing about growth. We were hearing about church plants. We were hearing about the Holy Spirit of God moving in new ways. And we got the official reports about attendance and everything at this assembly, or it came out right around the assembly time. And both in terms of membership, and in terms of the number of congregations, and in terms of worship attendance, all three of those really significant metrics, the Anglican Church in North America is growing. It has rebounded from COVID. It's now grown past the pre-COVID numbers. And it's a church that, in a cultural context, a cultural milieu where it's a lot, where a lot of denominations and churches are struggling to grow, the fact that we're growing, I think really is a sign of the Holy Spirit's favor and God working. And it's just so exciting to just be a part of that, a small part of that. And so that was just a refreshing, celebratory atmosphere that really was new and exciting for me in many ways. At St. Vincent College, just to tell you what this picture is about, Mr. Rogers is from the city of Latrobe, Pennsylvania, is my understanding. And he left, I don't know, his estate or some kind of connections to St. Vincent College, even though he was himself a Presbyterian minister. This is a Roman Catholic college or institution. So they had the Fred Rogers Center, one of the buildings on campus is actually named after Mr. Rogers. They had a little museum. And among the other things they had was this plastic dinosaur with Mr. Rogers and his puppets painted on it. And I just thought that was kind of funny. So I got a picture with that. And talk about the worship services a little bit. The opening Eucharist was on, I guess it was on Wednesday. The College of Bishops arrived about a week, something like that, several days before the rest of us. And they had what's called conclave, and they actually had it in the basement, the crypt, the undercroft of the basilica. So underneath the floor of this picture right here. And they actually met in conclave to elect a new archbishop, a chief or lead a bishop who will preside at gatherings like this and represent the ACNA in conversation with other denominations and in conversation with other Anglican provinces. So the new archbishop is Steve Wood, and I got to hear his sermon from the closing worship service. And I thought, well, this guy is a solid evangelical, and I really feel good about him and his kind of record of growth and everything he's been a part of. So so Steve Wood was elected, and I think that's going to be continue to have good leadership for the province. We had the opening worship service on Wednesday, and it was, and I think that's what this picture is from, it was extremely hot. There's no air conditioning in some of these old buildings, or if there is, it's pretty lackluster by Louisiana standards. We had probably a couple of hundred vested clergy, bishops, deacons, priests, or presbyters, all march in this huge procession. It took us two hymns just to get everybody into the church, into the basilica. And last of all came in Foley Beach, who is the outgoing archbishop. And when we all got up in the choir stalls, all of us clergy, and we're singing praise to the Lord, the Almighty, at the top of our lungs. And I look and I see Foley Beach coming down the center aisle. And he looks like a man who's carrying a lot of weight on him. And maybe that was just because it was hot and we were all robed up and everything. Or maybe it's because he's been carrying a lot of weight. It was just one of those moments. I was almost moved to tears. It was just like the celebration of godly leadership, of what the Lord is doing, of being in this beautiful place, praising God together with his people. And it was really, the whole service really was just full of emotional moments for me where I just was moved. And it was a very, very confirming experience. One of the things that kind of went to this assembly thinking is I'm either going to feel confirmation in the decision that I've made to go into the ACNA, or I'm going to probably feel like, okay, this may have been a mistake. And everything about this conference was confirmation and reassurance and even excitement to be a part of the ACNA and what God is doing to gather people into a very robust, traditional, Bible-believing, Orthodox Christianity that is willing to be countercultural in the midst of late modern, postmodern, Western secularism, and to hold on to the old ways and to say, actually, this is the good way that people should be going. And so it was just everything about it was confirmation in that sense. The opening service, we had a preacher from England, pastor, rector of a large church, I think it's St. Ebb's in Oxford, England, and he's part of the evangelical movement trying to sort of save at least some part of the Church of England. They're having real trouble right now. It's a great, great message from him. We took this picture, just a few of us from my diocese, Western Gulf Coast, after the service. There was a lot more people, actually. There was a good number from our diocese at this gathering. But we took this one after the worship service was over. Again, the fellowship was just a great part of this whole experience for me. And I got to meet people from all over, bumped into just a couple of different just bishops who struck up conversations with me, bumped into Bob Duncan, who was the first Archbishop of the province. He had been the Episcopal bishop in the Episcopal Church, Episcopalian, Bishop of Pittsburgh, and he led most of his diocese out of the Episcopal Church and helped, really as one of the key leaders, gather the ACNA together. And I met Archbishop Bob just walking down a hall. He struck up a conversation with me, walking to the dorm one of the afternoons. I just happened to be walking next to Bishop, I think Lyons is how he says it, L-Y-O-N-S. And he struck up a conversation with me and was just telling me how excited he was about Steve Wood and the leadership going forward. And just to be able to just bump into these good and godly leaders, Foley Beach, I've already mentioned, I've been so impressed with Foley Beach and his leadership in the last few years for the province and really for Anglicanism around the world. Foley Beach has been a key leader, not just within the ACNA, but even beyond it, to help gather people together on the solid rock of the word of Christ and the teachings of Scripture. One of the people I sought out while I was there was Bishop Love, Bill Love, from he was the bishop of the Diocese of Albany in the Episcopal Church, and probably a year, year and a half maybe, before I was suspended in the UMC on my way kind of out the door, because I wanted to let people know the changes that were coming in the denomination and that they did have an opportunity to get out and they should at least consider that. Bill Love was, I think it was Bill, Bishop Love, was the bishop in Albany, New York. He was trying to hold fast to the faith once delivered to the saints, and he did not allow same-sex marriages or redefined marriage within his diocese. And the national church, the Episcopal Church, basically said, you have to. And he said, I'm not going to. And he was deposed and removed from his ministry as a bishop. And when I was kind of going through all my road bumps and suspension and everything on my way out of the UMC, Bishop Love was somebody who really was an inspiration to me. So I went out of my way to go find him and just shake his hand and tell him thank you. And I appreciated his witness without telling the whole story. Just being able to rub shoulders with people like that and to know that the province is being led by people like that was so encouraging and just a beautiful, beautiful experience. This is a picture from the farewell banquet for Foley Beach. He's going to continue to be a bishop in the ACNA, but he'll no longer be in that lead role as the archbishop and primate, is what they call that in Anglicanism, the first from prime first, the first bishop. So we had this farewell banquet. You can see this. There were, I think, about 1,000 people, maybe a little more than 1,000 people, and great spirit, lots of clergy, but lots of laity as well. And just good diversity of people. And it was, again, just the fellowship was great. One of the little things about going to this conference that I thought about later, as just one of those little good signs that was confirming for me, we had our Bible study every morning led by the Bishop of Singapore, and it was really good. And he was really digging into 2 Timothy and you know, looking at Greek words and everything. And we often had Bible studies at the beginning of our business day in Louisiana Conference in the United Methodist Church, at least in years past. The last couple of conferences I went to, I can't really remember. It seems like we had a guy come talk about race reconciliation and activism one year instead of having a Bible study, but maybe we did both, or maybe that was, I don't know. Point was, these were serious Bible studies. And I looked around and I noticed virtually everybody around me had their Bible out, had it open. They were following, people were taking notes. At least a couple of people on my row had their app with the Greek New Testament open, and they're looking at the Greek words as he's talking about it. And just these little indicators, there was just such a seriousness about the Word of God and about studying the Bible and really paying attention, really getting things clear, getting things correct. And that was refreshing and just kind of an exciting thing for me as well. So the growth, the celebration, the fellowship, the worship, and it was a variety in some ways of worship. When we gathered in the plenary meetings, it was a lot more like praise and worship songs, or some older praise and worship songs from like when the charismatic renewal was real big. We did a couple of newer praise and worship songs during communion, during the opening Eucharist. And then the most of the service was traditional hymns. We had it was a variety of musical styles. We had a boys choir, or a youth boys choir. They looked to be mostly teenagers to me, sing at most of the services, the big services, and they were amazing. They were singing traditional polyphony or sacred choral music, including Ubi Caritas, that if you were at our wedding, the choir actually sang it. That was one of those kind of special personal connections. It was like, oh, yes, because I had picked that or asked for that at our wedding. There were a lot of little moments like that of just little connections. But the music, the worship, everything about it was amazing. One of the things that was really, again, encouraging, exciting to me, at least with my background in evangelicalism and a little bit in kind of sprinkles of the charismatic movement, during the communion service and the opening worship in this big, beautiful space, this worship service, it looks like it could be at the Vatican or something, very liturgical, very beautiful, very ornate, lots of robes and even incense and all this. During the communion, they asked if anybody wanted to receive prayer. You got something going on in your life, or the Lord is dealing with you, you need to pray. Some of the bishops kind of got off to the sides of the transepts and they would pray for people. And during communion, we actually sang all the choruses and songs that were printed in our bulletins. And we actually went back and sang one of them straight through again, because there were so many people who were still being prayed over. And I was like, this kind of brings me back to my like Baptist church revival days, where you sing Just As I Am and you sing all seven verses or whatever. And then, well, we need to sing them again, you know, because people are still coming forward. People are still being prayed over. And so one of the things that Anglicanism talks a lot about, especially the ACNA, is bringing together different streams, the traditional sacramental with the evangelical and the spirit-filled and the liturgical, and holding all that together. And that was one of those moments where you saw that beautifully in action. It was just a really exciting, renewing event. I was so glad to have been there and to have been a part of it. And I encourage you to learn more about the ACNA if you would like to. And I'd be happy to answer questions and do more content like this. So feel free to hit that thumbs up and share and all that good stuff. Until we connect again, I pray that the Lord will bless you and keep you and give you his peace. Amen.